today's panel discussion, we'll hear some of those stories from our eminent panelists, that what is their experiences of using innovation to solve some of the product startup are focusing on the social welfare system. We have three priorities. One, how we can support government in moving from the program-centric welfare system to a family-centric welfare system. What I mean by that? That let's not push money. Our economy is already, trying its best to cope up with the pandemic damage, but rather focus on, programs which are focusing on the needs, the specific needs of families. Two, how this welfare system can be progressive. As of now, welfare is an entitlement. How we can ensure that, we are providing welfare in a time-bound manner so that the families define the exit point and they actually are empowered enough and actually realizing the vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat. Third, which is one source, one data, and which we say that, if you are sharing so many data points with so many agencies, there should be a time when many services can be automated. You need not apply for those services. Now, to realize this challenging vision, because I'm talking about a welfare spend of close to 15 lakh crores, which is around 7% of our GDP, and a 1.3 billion population, right? We relied on a technology platform. It's an artificial intelligence-driven technology platform. And I intentionally quoted these numbers, right? When I talked about the billion population and 15 lakh crores, which is a huge sum of money. So using our product, the EasyGov product with state governments in Karnataka, Bihar, Haryana, and we are also working with MyGov, we're able to reach close to 2 crore users. We're able to see around 1 lakh users coming to our app to check their eligibility for various welfare schemes. Still, there's a long way to go, right? Now, we'll bring in the two C's back to the discussion, which is collaboration and community engagement. Now, if you really want to make this number 10x or 1000x to cover our large population, the large country, I think all of us need to work together. And there are so many stories in today's panel discussion, which I think all the audience will appreciate, that how actors from different areas, starting from government or private sector, actually work together during pandemic. This is a very good challenge which actually brought everybody together, that how we can combine our strength and start solving the issues. So with this, I open the discussion and invite Rachna to talk about her experiences, from being a, I would say, an investor, a mentor, and a CSR leader, that how exactly she transitioned in the pre-COVID to the post-COVID, post-COVID. I'm talking about a bit futuristic scenario, that how she navigated through these challenges and actually saw some of the transformations there. And as Yamini hinted at, we have 8 minutes, for each panelist. So please restrict your sharing with that. And obviously, we'll have more time to have offline discussions. Over to you.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you so much. So early evening. So good evening, everyone. And I've been thinking about how to sort of set context for what I want to say in 8 minutes. And, obviously all of us are in this pandemic together. And more than anything, I think the solidarity in the social sector, I feel, has strengthened in some ways. And for us, from a CSR portfolio perspective, at the bank, disability and mental health is, a very deep focus. I don't want to get into what else we do. It's on our website. It's an annual report, right? So I think before we all went into the lockdown and really realized the gravity of the pandemic, we were supporting Tactopus, which is a for-profit social enterprise. And they are essentially in the field of using technology and creating multi-sensory products to make classrooms inclusive for children with different learning needs, right? Now, the way they were solving it before the pandemic was they had a physical product which had to be manufactured, because for blind children, there were tactile graphics, and then there was, some amount of audio inputs also in the product. And so when the lockdown was announced, production completely, manufacturing stopped, right? And I think at the core of it, if we, we do adopt an ecosystem approach to the problems we solve. So at the heart of the issue is the child with the disability or the special needs, right? And then you have the parents, you have the specialists, you have society where constantly a lot of stigma around what the child can do, what they can't do is constantly sort of impacting the experience of the child in this universe. And so previously, before the lockdown, we were solving for some of these issues in the classroom. It was very product-centric, where the product was sold to teachers in the classroom, and the bank co-invested with Social Alpha. Social Alpha, have equity investment, and we gave a grant because obviously it's very early stage, and for a very niche area, for a very niche startup that is solving a problem in the disability sector, you really need a lot of patient grants and capital. So we actually had a major opportunity that sort of, hit us in the face, actually, because when production stopped, we realized that, okay, how do we continue engaging parents who are our key stakeholder? And that's when we started learning that in the lockdown, parents were completely caught off guard because they were so used to going to the special school, dropping their kids, going to work or going back home and then coming back to pick them up, right? They didn't really know what happened as much in those few hours. And their only role was to monitor what the child was experiencing in the form of therapy in the classroom. Now, if you read, even literature online, parents of children with special needs have actually had to forcefully become co-therapists, right? So what we did is we held a series of focus group discussions. We sort of spoke to the educators. They lost clientele. They don't know how to reach clientele. The parents were suffering because they didn't know what to do with the children at home. So all of this together really formed the, the foundation of what we launched recently as Tactopus Connect. You can go to their website and check it out. And so Tactopus Connect essentially is a low-cost, platform where we try to serve, where we service parents. And interestingly, all of this, the cost, the distance, because a lot of times parents have actually migrated from smaller towns to cities just because there was no special educator in their town. So, right, so the non-availability of specialists, low cost was an issue. And also it wasn't data driven, right? In the past, a physiotherapist would do his or her job, some other therapist would do something else, and the shadow teacher would do something else. So nobody was really speaking to each other as much. And now when it's digital, it's even more harder because these therapists aren't even meeting each other face to face in a school. So we're trying to solve for all of these problems that all that did exist. But I think using tech, we've just really been able to hit. We are really able because it is a for-profit business, right? We cannot endlessly fund, we cannot fund Tactopus endlessly through, through grant funding. So we are looking at a hybrid model where we are trying to charge parents who can pay. They're living in cities. They earn significantly better than those in rural areas. And we're trying to cross-subsidize. We're also trying to raise CSR funding for those who cannot afford it because BP, people at the bottom of the pyramid, again, will not have access to great devices for internet, and to access the service online. So through CSR funding, again, we are trying to see how can some of those be supported. Some of the early customer insights we're getting are interesting. We're also learning that, we actually may have to offer some services to parents itself to skill them, because skilling the children alone is not enough, right? Because we don't know when we're going to go back to normal. So there is a lot of uncertainty looming. But I think that together with the startup, with the bank, even connecting Tactopus to our other NGOs that we support in disability to get customer insights, we've really been able to crack the scale, that we really hadn't even thought of before before the lockdown. So in a way, it has really been a big opportunity for us and for the organization. I hope 8 minutes is, I'm trying to wrap it up soon.
No, I think you're sharing such an impactful story. We didn't keep account of the time, but I think I'm sure you're within the time. So thanks, Rachna. I think you talked about multiple, facets, starting from the power of digital and also some of the limitations of digital, which we need to, understand while we are devising the solution, right? You talked about the child at the center, right? Which is very, very important point, because sometimes we forget in the obsession of using advanced technology, but you kept child at the center. You talked about sustainable models as well, which is very important for social space. And I think you very well articulated the power of collaboration, which we have been talking about, and how exactly collaboration helped you in, navigating through this challenge. So let me, move to Rajashree now. And considering the deep expertise, you know, she brings in an experience, you know, the question for her is, how do you see technology maximizing the impact and becoming part of mainstream in recent days? What are your experiences from innovative solutions you have seen and the role collaborations played? So I will keep repeating the word collaboration in all the questions, and this is what we are meant for. Over to you, Rajshri.
Sure, Anurag. As you rightly pointed, hope I am audible now. Okay.
Yeah, you're audible.
Yes, yeah. Testing first, right?
Yes. As
you said. So as you rightly mentioned, you know, I'll start with partnership. And I always consider, we always consider these as actually very critical factors for any of mainstreaming the solutions. You know, we always keep it simple and cognizant. That's four P's: partnership, people, process, and a platform. Okay, so I'll start with partnership. I mean, as you rightly mentioned, collaboration is the key here because mere technology would not help. We need the innovator to work with a variety of stakeholders here, starting with the service providers. In fact, for many of our innovator, I mean, if the innovator is kind of, you know, it's a separate social enterprise by itself, the first thing we ask them is that with which other service provider they are working closely, you know, who's your lighthouse partner or a customer or a beneficiary here. So they need to work with the NGO partners who provides the service to the community, because that's when the technology solution gets validated. And that helps to understand the community need and also evolve the solution and the innovation better. I can give several examples here, but I'll start and continue with the previous healthcare panel here, because one of our focus area is healthcare, and we work in three verticals: health, education, and livelihood. So I'll be switching across. And in health, we focus on preventing avoidable blindness. Okay, so I mean, bulk of our 2.7 million lives we've touched only in healthcare, and out of this 1.6 is entirely in avoidable blindness. Why? Because India carries a very dubious, you know, statistics is that we carry the close to 1/3 of burden of the world blind and the visually impaired people. So the problem is there plenty, which means there is so much of a scope for innovation here, right? So one of the example that I would want to give is like this IIT Madras incubated company, the Forest Health, you know, where they were working. It's a medical technology company, and they carry the same goal like us, like preventing avoidable blindness. So that's resonated with us. And they've been working on the technology innovation and also creating business models which will help them to make it as a sustainable, affordable access to vision care in rural areas and remote parts. So all the products, starting from the Trinetra Classic, which is basically a compact, portable, easy to use, digital imaging device, to their Trinetra Neo. No, like with all the devices, we were actually going with our devices. But then we encouraged them, and we also connected with variety of our healthcare providers, starting from Shankara, like Vishwa Sevas, all rural areas, community eye care in Pune and so on. And all major partners like Arvind and Dr. Shroff, Beat, Shankar Netralia, Shankara, we have been working with them as partnership because we focus on avoidable blindness. So we were encouraging that how this particular devices or their family of devices can actually replace some of the imported costly items. For example, the Trinetra Neo is something that's an indigenous lower priced alternative for imported red cam. The cost of the red cam is typically 5 to 6 times of the cost of what is new camera is. So how can we actually make some of the programs like retinopathy of prematurity, like, you know, which is basically the child who are born premature, underweight babies, you know, they have a higher probability of going blind for the life. So not much of an awareness was there in the country. So we picked up a few programs after, I think, Queen Elizabeth Diamond Jubilee Trust and a few of the other big partners. I mean, like VPI is one of our big partners. They were actually promoting ROP in a big way. So we started partnering, and now we're doing multiple places and multiple states this ROP program. And now the cost of the ROP program has kind of substantially come down because of these innovations where, you know, some of these indigenous devices have replaced these imported devices. So we do it in Andhra, Telangana, Odisha, Tamil Nadu, and as well as Maharashtra, also 5 states. So these are, I mean, multiple hospitals, Arvind, HV, Desai, Medjar, but the device or the technology actually continues across. You know, who is our partner is a social innovation, and this particular innovation has actually kind of made it mainstream, I would say. And the another innovation that I would talk about is again another healthcare example, which is actually for women and child health. And we work on infant mortality rate as well. Again, as much as we focus on preventing blindness, we also want to improve the low weight babies, you know, to get saved, and wanted to reduce the infant mortality. So we've been working on a lot of SNCUs, which is called a special neonatal care units, and an ICUs to actually work on that. And one such, this is actually a project, this is actually a device, an IoT-based device in Elixon, again, IIT Madras incubated company, which actually monitors the temperature differences. And when these babies get discharged out of these NICUs, and only if there is a risk warning, you know, to alert not only the parents, but also the ASHA workers or the HNs and as well as the base hospitals to ensure that the actually baby gets a timely intervention. And in fact, this was the project which was just out of pilot. The device was validated. And one more thing that I wanted to move from partnership is also the process as the next critical factor. Because one thing that we realize is not just about the technology getting validated, the mainstreaming it requires the processes for mainstreaming also need to get validated. I mean, healthcare industry, obviously all devices get validated, but when it has to be tested into this public system, the processes of how to mainstream that also needs to get validated. So we work with IIT Madras again and work with multiple districts across Tamil Nadu with variety of hospitals. And just when we're about to roll out this project, actually COVID-19 and the lockdown set in. And then we were wondering whether to do this, is this the right time to do? And then we realized that more and more healthcare people coming back and saying that actually this is now the maternal and childhood is actually losing its importance because most of the healthcare workers are now into the COVID-19. So it'll be even more beneficial for the society to make the innovation now because because of this device, you know, people need not unnecessarily keep traveling to the hospitals and the hospitals will have less of the load. And they, again, can be rest assured because it's an IoT-based warning system to tell based on the temperature whether the baby is at risk or not. And only the intervention when it's required, it can be done. So these are the couple of things that we learned. Definitely partnership is key and process is key. And again, as part of this, we are just taking it, ensuring all the training for the nurses is now done digitally as part of this project. I mean, of course, you know, the entire education and skilling industry, as we all know that, you know, they have it's been almost the digital learning has been on steroids, so to say. We always want innovation to go viral, but not necessarily with coronavirus, but the innovation to go viral. But it's been a, but it's been interesting to see that how this entire project, you know, is kind of taken off and it's kind of moving ahead. I mean, this is still in the process of getting mainstream, I would say. And as when Dr. Potti is here, I would also want to come back and talk about our COVID-19 work. And the initial days, you know, when we wanted, since of our focus in healthcare, we wanted to focus on protecting the frontline workers. So all the N95 masks and the PPE kits, when we were scratching, it was so much in short supply, you know, and suddenly all our focus became like the procurement department chasing all the vendor partners to say that what's the stock supply, what's available and so on. And people even she will talk about more, so I will not steal away her part. But you know, some of those incubated companies like trying to make this mask at a very, very affordable, lower cost, the N95 mask, that has really come handy. Of course, we wish that it was there in March, April, but I'm sure that we at least got to benefit out of those such innovations actually in the later part. So definitely agility is the third part that I want to talk about as part of the process. Because it's not just about validating the process, agility to adapt, react to the situation. I think as a country that we are very resilient, we are pretty agile. We need to channelize our agility for a very clear focus. And we don't need a virus all the time for us to stay focused. But definitely the agility to adapt actually brought many people together, multiple stakeholders to come together, to partner and as well as, get these processes validated in a very fast time to market. Okay. And of course, the third part, I like the way in which she put it, keeping the child in the center. So we always say that any innovation and technology, we need to keep the people in the center. Next to partnership and process, we see people is important for mainstreaming. And actually, people keeping the people in the center cannot come only in the mainstream. I will say right from the initial design of the innovation or the technology solution. I mean, it cannot be after piloting, but it is even more important when you need to mainstream a solution. Because it is important that we need to understand there is a lot of persistent efforts that's required for influencing behavior and driving change management. It can never be underestimated. And as I said, we are very happy to see most of our skilling partners, training partners, education, and wherever we worked on the digital learning in the education, and definitely people have quickly adapted and moved to digital mode of teaching learning in the COVID times. But otherwise, how do we make this influencing the behavior and how can this innovation go viral without the virus, as I said. So that's something that we have to design, keeping the users in mind and keeping the people in mind. Keeping it simple, keeping it frugal, and the lean startup way, test early and fail early, like, you know, go a long way. And we have some learnings as well there, you know, like we're working with one of the education, we work with them, it's called Do Kahani Suno project with Pratham Books. Basically, it is like to ensure that it's actually very frugal innovation using just SMS. The children who have actually lost their access to school education and are only sitting before TV for their education, can they at least listen to stories? You know, this is through the SMS. So we are still trying to understand that how the users are behaving in that. Of course, you know, we thought it's actually already crossed the pilot phase, but when we have initiated this, now we're trying to understand how long people are actually staying connected to the call and how, when they're actually dropping off, how many children are listening to the stories, how many are repeat stories. So this kind of keeping and understanding, we also follow. And it's not just about keeping the technology and rolling out. We work with our volunteer folks. We work with our partners. We ensure we reach out and collect as much feedback as possible directly, indirectly, through all sources to ensure that this innovation can get to mainstream. For that, it's very important is actually follow the users and follow the beneficiaries and follow the people like who are actually going to use the innovation. And understanding the user behavior, understanding that feedback goes a long way. And of course, I'll stop here, pass you. I don't want to exceed my 8 minutes. But two more things that I felt it's important for mainstreaming is that we should actually focus on problems that are not solved. I mean, in some areas, we find technology and innovation overcrowding. And there are some in some areas. I mean, for example, the same skill training as I talk about, you know, when it comes to engineering, vocational training, how do you do it digitally, right? It's not a problem yet completely solved. But we see some early signs. Again, we work with a couple of IT Madras incubated companies like Skillvery, which have used some vocational learning using building simulators and so on. Similarly, some remote areas, you know, and people who are speaking in different dialects, most of the edutech focusing on traditional languages and so on. But how do we address tribal children? So we have some experiments and experiences there. So focusing on the problems that are not solved, that's another area that which we choose when we talk about, you know, picking up technology solutions. And last but not the least, keeping sustainability in mind. Financial sustainability, whether the community is who is going to own it directly or finally it is alignment to the existing schemes from the government. We need to maximize the impact and should also sustain the impact. So these are some factors that we apply when we consider mainstreaming a solution. In fact, it goes much beyond mainstreaming. We focus on mainstreaming a lot of technology innovation as part of our project portfolio. But we apply this as a criteria to check, you know, which of these technologies is going to be most sustainable, which is, I mean, it is really focusing on problems that are not solved. And which is really, of course, everything has to improve the efficiency, effectiveness, impact, and so on. But keeping the people at the center, and whether their processes, I mean, they have a solid process to validate the processes supporting the mainstreaming of this particular solution. I mean, is the team agile? Is the process allows agility? And finally, are all the stakeholders, you know, partnering on this together? So this is something that we apply as a guiding force and a checklist for all our projects. I'll pass you out.
Thanks, Ajashi. Quite a power-packed sharing, I would say. You know, there are so many experiences you're able to share, right? And you brought in a different perspective to the collaboration, right? So collaboration not only helped you scale, but also reduce the cost, which is very important, you know, especially in our country, right? We really want to be more self-dependent. And I think COVID taught us that why we should be self-dependent. We should not be dependent on other nations, right? And I think you also talked about the powerful collaboration story, which obviously Dr. Sapna will highlight, that how exactly, you know, different organizations work together with the government, you know, to fight the pandemic, and still the fight is on, right? Agility to adapt is another important part, and the process to bring the technology to mainstream. Now, for me, process becomes very important at EasyGov, because when we talk about process, we're talking about government policies. You cannot bring in any kind of reform unless you tweak the policies. And you know, if you tweak the policies, what happens, right? We are seeing it nowadays. So I think process is very important. Sustainability, it came out in both Rachna's sharing and your sharing, that unless we make it sustainable, we have seen so many social pilot stage, you know, starting from scaling or other initiative where you do a small pilot and you stop there, right? Which is not good, because there are so many efforts which you put in terms of pilot. Now I will move on, because I think all of us are eager to know from Dr. Sapna. You know, she is leading the fight against COVID. She has been the master collaborator. I think government has been one common thread. We are working with government. Rajshri is working with government. Rachna is working with government. right? So I would say the master collaborator is government, right? So you are the people who actually help us solve those problems where the priorities are not there. As Rajshree rightly pointed out, that you know there are times when there is overinvestment in specific areas and there are so many areas which we ignore. So over to you, Dr. Sapna. You would want to share your learnings and about the technology landscape in India.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anurag and Bhaumik, Shilpi, all of you. You've been really wonderful and patient with me throughout this, up to this session. So basically, I would like to step back a couple of steps to actually understand why is it important to have R&D as a CSR in the Schedule 7 and incubation of technologies and so on. Globally, as you would be aware, that it's industry which runs the entire R&D or technology development in almost all the developed countries. Government is there as part of the story, but it's only largely for scale up and so on. But most of the thinking, most of the funding, as well as the proof of concept, all of that is done by the industry and with the industry. So it's very important. And that's how we, from the Office of the Principal Scientific Advisor, we actually brought in this element to the Schedule 7, requesting Ministry of Corporate Affairs to add R&D and incubation. This historical moment was required because of the fact that any output of R&D is a multiplier, has a multiplier effect in the country. It's not that you feed a set number of people and that story is ended. It has a multiplier effect. It solves issues which are at a national level and at global levels as well. So hence it is important, if not more important than several other listed in the Schedule 7. So that is the point number one I wanted to make. Point number two is when COVID hit us, almost all of us in the science and technology field were equally startled as a common man. But we all got together, and especially our youth, the startups, they really went that extra mile to come together to solve this issue along with the other stakeholders. And the best part of the story was that absolutely 99 to 100% of the work that we have done on COVID from our office has been thanks to the industry. They have come forward not only with CSR funding, they also brought in technical assistance and also worked with us on manufacturing some of these components. And then, of course, the last mile connectivity through by distribution and so on, which Rajshree mentioned. So during this period, about 56 to 60 innovations is what we brought out through the with the help of industries, right from testing kits, antigen testing kits, your RT-PCR and so on, which IIT Delhi, IIT Madras worked on, Indian Institute of Science worked on it. Then we had ventilators and components of ventilators, which were innovated, low cost and high quality. IIT Kanpur, along with Cummins, along with Mahindras and so on, they built ventilators for us. We had mobile diagnostic labs and different designs by Indian Institute of Science, DRDO. We worked with Gates Foundation and some of the larger global foundations helped us with mobile diagnostic labs. SBI Foundation was the other organization. And in this milieu, if you realize, most of the funds of CSR was actually parked with the PM CARES. So very little was available with the industry, but very innovatively, industry actually handpicked the projects with us, and mostly it was the banks, it was the IT-ITS and those kind of organizations who had some surplus funds left with them who actually supported us in these endeavors. So we also had, of course, masks and PPEs and so on. So like I said, about 56 to about 58 to 60 innovations which we brought out to the larger nation per se. So the entire value chain was looked after. One is, of course, to innovate. And the other one was to distribute these. So some of the organizations said that, we will wait for you to innovate and then we will support in the distribution. For instance, in the case of vaccination, I'm guessing it will be the same story where once the vaccination is out, we will need to take it to the common man. And that's where we will, again, require a lot of CSR funds and support. there were organizations like Microsoft, like we had Infineon. They helped with technical assistance with artificial intelligence. A lot of AI and machine learning is required when you build testing, because you do a lot of algorithms, modeling, etc. So they offered global resources, not only Indian resources. So that is something which was remarkable at that juncture. We had Infineon, which has knowledge on ventilators. So they offered, they handpicked all the ventilator projects from different IITs and Institute of Science and so on. So the main role that the Office of the Principal Scientific Advisor wants to undertake and has undertaken quite beautifully during COVID times and even now, when we are actually moved from 60 projects to about 140 projects, which is non-COVID projects included, is that we reach out to all the IITs, to the startups, private as well as national incubators, 8 research parks, CSIRs, ISERS, NITs, and so on. Basically, the creme of the creme in terms of those who are the best in technologies as well as in scientific research. And we get them to work with us closely on challenges and on innovations and technologies which are relevant for national missions. So COVID was one such element which we did quite well. Similarly, during that time, as you recall, that there was a lot of migration. So we did an entire movement called the Kisan Mitra movement, where we brought in all the agriculture technologies, livestock technologies, scientific research, agri-finance technologies, and off-farm, which is Kala Mitra, as we call it, technologies into this movement called Kisan Mitra. And all of these were housed in one platform where the technologies could talk to the farmers, to the incubators, because these technologies are at different levels. It could be at TRL 3 or TRL 9, or it could be field tested, or it could be market ready. So the customers for these technologies are completely different. So they can engage on the platform on Kisan Mitra. And similarly, we also built an app where we actually discussed with each of these ministries, which house a lot of databases, which are satellite data relevant for the farmers, be it moisture, water. Jal Ministry has data on canals, on on surface water, and so on. So a lot of these ministries have databases which are very useful. Similarly, Ministry of Agriculture had soil data, and we had Ministry of Statistics, which had a whole host of pest data and so on. So, getting these databases and speaking to these databases, making it into simpler language for the farmers was the other project that we did. And Tech Mahindra and a trust, which is a Bangalore trust called ICST, also helped us with this entire exercise for the farmers. Similarly, NASSCOM Foundation came forward, IIM Bangalore came forward, and then we also had National Institute of Agriculture Marketing. So a truly PPP model where the public and private partnership managed to take these technologies to the farmers during this time. And this, of course, will be a continued effort where we have garnered the ITI network, the KVKs, as well as the IFCO Bazaar, if you have heard of this organization, which works with the field officers and so on, through the field officers taking these agriculture technologies to the farmers. So COVID had health as well as agriculture as the main themes. Similarly, now we are working with water mission projects where organizations like Hindustan Unilever, you have Toilet Board Coalition, they're working with us on sanitation, water, and so on. CSR Box themselves have come forward and requested us to facilitate some of these innovations where they would like to take it to the CSR members so that people can understand what is the research and development which is being undertaken, support some of this R&D so that, as I said, that it could be a multiplier effect. And similarly, we have rural development and so on. It could be through setting up a center of excellence in any of these academic institutes, or it could be supporting the R&D projects, individuals' R&D projects, or it could be innovation challenges that organizations like Indian Oil Corporation or you have GAIL and some of the public sector units. Today, in fact, I was talking to Amazon. They are offering their computing services pro bono for the startups and so on. So several organizations have come forward with their strengths, be it funding, and many times along with funding, they also come with technical expertise or their domain in-kind kind of support along with the funding to these institutes and startups, because there's a lot of hope and there's a lot of energy and drive that the academic institutes and incubated startups have shown during COVID, which we would like to continue to work on different national missions of importance. So I would like to close with this, and happy to take questions. This is what we have been trying to achieve from the last 10 months, and we have done tremendously well so far. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Sapna. And as I said, government is the master collaborator, right? So the master facilitator, and you have named academic institutions, foundations, so many organizations. And I think this platform gave us an opportunity to hear something which happened, behind the curtain, right? So application of artificial intelligence, machine learning, the collaboration across organizations, I think such a fabulous story. What we may want to, work on, as together, including the audience and my fellow panelists, that all these innovations should not be restricted to the pandemic, right? So there are so many things would have happened just because there was a pandemic, right? We need to scale these innovations. And as Dr. Sapna rightly pointed out, that how R&D can be, adopted at the commercial side and the corporate side. And India has seen so many innovations. Maybe there are many innovations we are not even aware of, which has happened, in past, past 1 year. So, we can open for the questions, because I'm sure audience will have so many questions seeing such an eminent panel. Over to you, Yamini, if you can just put some questions. Yamini? I think is not. So Dr. Sapna, while she resumes, what are we doing, in terms of as a government initiative to identify those innovations, right, which have happened as part of pandemic? Because you are the person who's sitting at the center, right? You are talking to so many industrial bodies and so many foundations, academic institutions and all. Are you planning some initiative where we can actually, think of scaling these innovations?
Yeah, that's a very brilliant question that you've asked me. We have something called the Empowered Technology Group under the Principal Scientific Advisor, where we have almost all the line ministry secretaries who work on social development areas. So a lot of these innovations that we have undertaken, not only during COVID, also on any industry academia collaborations that we are talking about, we have taken some of these proof of concept, as we call it. Once the technology is built, it's pilot tested, and then there's a proof of concept, which we do from this entire partnership that we have with the industry on CSR funded R&D. So then we take it to these line ministries and we showcase it, and quite a few of these technologies then get scaled up, because government is the largest funding organization. So we can only do a proof of concept with the industry CSR funding. However, the scale up has to be done by the government. So a lot of line ministries have been educated on the kind of proof of concept and technologies that we have built, and they have taken it up and scaled it up. And similarly, during COVID, we had HLL, which is a public sector unit, which has taken a lot of ventilators as well as the masks and PPE projects, including, of course, testing kits and so on. And they have manufactured it in on scale. And some of it has been utilized through the government hospitals and given back to the common man. So that is why the Office of Principal Scientific Advisor is a single point of contact for you, because one, the outreach to the institutes is easier for any CSR or industry. And this includes industry R&D, not only CSR, of course. So one is that we do an outreach and we are a knowledge partner. So we also help you to articulate the challenge, etc. But more importantly, once the innovation is undertaken, we could also sell it further to the line ministries so that they take it forward. And so the entire value chain is within this office.
Thanks, Dr. Sapna. Now I have a question for Rajeshree.
Yeah, I saw that.
From Satyendra Goswami.
Yeah, I saw that question. How does data collection tool help in mitigating the social sector challenges? I mean, whether can a pilot study be conducted through it? So we don't do it as actually a database research as a separate activity, not as a post facto. But most of our projects and large projects actually has data collection embedded in it. In fact, before embarking on a larger one, sometimes even as part of the feasibility study, we undertook one project for rebuilding a set of community after the 2015 floods in Chennai. So it had actually a feasibility study as part of that. It's more a participatory rural appraisal because that particular project was actually for the rural communities. So there was a participatory rural appraisal and a data collection that was actually built in as part of the program. Even if the data collection is not built in as part of the project, we always look at secondary data research just before taking up the project because that gives us a lot of insight about. And as I mentioned earlier before, I mean, it's not for the technology or innovation for the sake of it, right? We pick up projects with a structure of very similar to the OECD's framework. We look for relevance, coherence, relevance. Is it relevant for the community, for the geography, for the project is relevant? Coherent, is it like, how it's kind of aligned or misaligned with other initiatives? Sometimes we need to look at alignment. Sometimes we need to look at conflicting initiatives in the particular geography as well. Efficiency, whether this particular solution or a proof has worked in the past efficiently, effectively. And finally, like the impact or the potential impact and sustainability. So these are the criteria that we apply upfront. So to that extent, we look at secondary research, secondary data, starting from the demographic of that particular population or that area. If we take a project, we look at, for example, any avoidable blindness, we look at the prevalence rate, in a particular. We were always restricting to the geographies where cognizant had presence. Then later we realized Assam was actually a very good, very high prevalence rate for eye ailment. So we added Assam as actually a state as part of our, so that way we rely a lot on secondary data. We don't look at data collection as a separate exercise or a project. In large project, yes, it's embedded as part of the projects. Apart from Goswami's project, I think there is another question, probably is directed to me, Mr. Madhav. He's also talked about some nursing or something in the beginning, right? Saying that how can and low cost, sustainable hospital, whether it should be an objective or so. I'm not sure whether it's for the previous session or this session. Okay. But anyway, that I wanted to actually talk about a particular model about this low cost and sustainability. And I feel that in healthcare, right? Somehow, like the Aravind model or the much talked about our case study, whatever it is, they seem to, particularly in the eye area, they seem to have worked out a model which is highly cross-subsidized and it's quite sustainable. In that sense, the people who can afford to pay are paying, and the others, and again, the people who cannot afford to pay, that they are actually getting the benefit of the free services and so on. Of course, the outreach and community initiatives are corporate-sponsored like us, and then they are linked to government schemes. So by and large, they kind of try and collect all the stakeholders for financial sustainability. A part of it is communities owning, and part of it is actually community paying by cross-subsidizing. Part of it is through corporate and philanthropic contributions, and part through the government scheme and so on. So that's kind of seem to bring in a model, which is a good. I'm not saying that the same will apply for all technology innovation to make it financially sustainable. In each one has its unique case, right? How it's going to be sustainable. But we need to, that needs to be thought through upfront. So that's something that I thought there was a couple of questions on that, specifically on the low cost hospitals and so on. So I thought I'll pick it up. Yeah.
Thanks, Rajshree. I don't think there are many questions here.
There's one more on governance structure. One more on governance structure to be ensured while bringing. I thought it is Dr. Sapna Putti's question, so I'm not answering that.
Please go ahead, Dr. Sapna.
Yeah, so what is the question?
How can the governance structure be ensured while bringing technology and innovation? So I thought it's a government question.
Okay. So, like I said, that, we have the entire Empower Technology Group, and we also engage very closely with the land ministries to take these innovations to the land ministry and scale up and so on. The other element that we do is we have certain movements. Like, for instance, Kisan Mitra was an agriculture movement for the farmers and so on, using science and technology. Similarly, we would have something on air pollution where we would like all CSR organizations, foundations, coalitions, consortiums, multinationals to come together with us where we bring the collaborators together. and we actually innovate as well as ensure we take a stock of what's already there on air pollution and do certain proof of concept and take it to the ground. Similarly, we would like to do it on WASH, where we work on sludge management, or we work on waste to energy and so on separately. And also a similar domain would be MSMEs. So these would be special movements where we have the entire value chain mapped out and all the collaborators working together, where our office would be the one which will be pivotal and which will be centralized, taking all the collaborators together and then of course having outcomes. So what I am particular about as an individual is that we should always walk the talk and not just keep talking. So most of the outcomes and output from the Principal Scientific Advisor's office would be there on the PSA portal for you to see, because our focus would be there. So the governance structure would ideally go through these entire value chains and go up to the line ministry and scale up and so on.
Right.
I see one more question on the healthcare again on the Q&A. So probably I'll take it. There are a lot of gaps in terms of facilities and manpower between urban and rural hospitals, and how do we mitigate? I'll specifically talk about a couple of innovations, at least as we see it. And yes, the gap is huge. I mean, if you take healthcare, it's not only the affordability, the access is a big issue, right? It's not the same level of facilities between the rural and urban. And I happen to kind of listen to the last part of the previous session as well, how do we actually encourage the capacity building, particularly the manpower capacity in rural India and so on. Couple of innovation, definitely telemedicine is picking up, and at least we can speak for the teleophthalmic consulting. And more than the teleophthalmic consulting, we do a lot. If you see in India, it's a tertiary, secondary and a primary setup. So the primary is the rural thing. And I mean, I don't think that we can replicate the entire tertiary facility at a primary level. It's just not possible. I mean, definitely, that kind of an access for that kind of a service, people need to move to the specialized care at the tertiary centers. But definitely primary healthcare can be a lot strengthened, and particularly the diagnosis using the teleconsulting and other things. So those are some of the projects that where we have worked, particularly teleconsulting and so on. Some of the earlier medical devices and other things that I talked about earlier, this not only does the imaging, but it also retains those images, transfers it back to the tertiary care centers for secondary consulting. So on. So those are actually possible, and definitely that is kind of bridging the gap a bit. And one more project that, since that particular question came, that we have worked with the part of Maharashtra actually the project is Pan-India, is an Impact India Foundation. It's basically a hospital on wheels, where we have set up actually a cancer diagnosis and as well as an eye surgery unit in two trained coaches. This is much before COVID, when people are talking about quarantine centers and COVID care centers and coaches. This is actually still a train that's running to all the remote parts of India. And actually, there is a camp that kind of prepares the community before the train arrives there. And once the train reaches there, it's basically started with preventing disabilities, starting from the cleft and then the other ortho areas and dental and then the eye care. Now, there is also a separate course that Cognizant Foundation has worked with them for setting up the Cancer Diagnosis Center. So these are some of the projects definitely where innovation is possible. As I said, we should also focus on the problems not solved, and definitely that problem is not completely solved. The rural and the urban healthcare is not completely equal, but innovation is possible there. So with that positive note, I would pass there for that question.
I just want to add one or two points to that. We have innovations such as standing wheelchair by IIT Madras. We also have delicate things like eye operations, again from IIT Madras, which is mobile vans for eye operations, which we have done with Naranitralai and so on. And I mean, each of the institutes that I've been mentioning, about 60 to 100 of these institutes, and even newer IITs and NITs, they have centers of excellence, and they of course have scope for augmenting quite a few of that. But a lot of innovations on health sector, and health sector is the most common, along with education technologies that institutes are working on.
Right. Thanks, Dr. Sapna. And I think we are towards the closure of the session. So, I request all the participants that, you can reach out to us offline. We all are, eager to collaborate. Right, from EasyGov, if you really want to create any kind of awareness about a social campaign, if you want to leverage our app, we'll be happy to do that. We have close to 50 crore reach of around 50 crore customers. right? And we can help you, create some kind of awareness of various initiatives. Now, I think collaboration is the word which I will conclude with, because we have heard so many stories. I think collaboration was a common thread. And I think technology brought in these collaborators on one platform, right? Because technology became one thread which actually got all diverse stakeholders to one place. So technology has a role to play, and we will definitely maintain the importance of human touch to it.